Did you see my transclusion email from this morning?
I did, Steve. Thank you. Yes, that sounds a good topic.
And give me a. We've got a few minutes, so let me. Can I just join?
Should be able to.
I should just be able to join that meeting. I don't want to start it because I think that might kick everybody off.
Yeah.
Join. And share. Hello, there I am.
Steve, I can see your screen.
You can. I'm ambushing you. What is this?
Wow. Okay, so there's two sidebars there. One's Lisa's real sidebar, and one's... Have a look. Can you switch to the... It looks like maybe she's got a template open, which has got the other sidebar in. Yeah, I would be closing some tiddlers and seeing if you can... you get something similar if you open the page template in TiddlyWiki. So that's the Tiddler that contains the layout of the entire page. And if you open it within a Tiddler, it's a sort of recursive explosion.
So how would she have done that?
She could have opened the shadow Tiddler that contains the shadow. Actually, I've just remembered the other. The most obvious thing is that she saved changes using the file save menu item on the browser. That's almost certainly what's happened.
That's what she did. So how do you undo that?
The best way is to start with the blank wiki and import that one.
You've already tried that.
Then yeah, it might take some manual.
Well, I think I fixed it for her because I emailed her a new one, have her test it. Let me pull that one up.
No, so this is like a serious bit of corruption, not a simple fix, right?
Oh, well, I mean, it's not that serious in that I think all of the data is there. It's right. What's not obvious is the smallest set of easily communicable steps that will fix the problem.
Okay.
But it's an interesting one that however many times we tell people not to use the file save menu, they do use the file save menu.
Yes, and that's one of the, this is the implication. Okay, so it's I was going to say it's nothing she did, but it's exactly something she did.
I fear if that theory is correct, then it is. But I mean, it's also something that's, it's a bit troublesome that it's a dangerous thing you can do within TiddlyWiki that comes fairly naturally to a lot of people. That's, you know, default action is, oh, yes, they've got to save changes. I'll press file save. You know, that's what you do in a word processor, after all. So it is an unfortunate set of circumstances that TiddlyWiki's presence in the browser encourages people to believe that it will work one way and then isn't able to give them any feedback, you know, when they try it and it doesn't work.
No, we've actually...
But what could you, perhaps Steve in the background or somebody, if you could email me a link to Lisa's example, I might as well take this opportunity to have a quick look at it and okay. See if I can figure out a decent fix.
Okay, I will do that. Actually, Jake, you have that, right?
Well, I have the one that I fixed for that I do believe it's working on my system. I helped her rebuild this one when we first had the problem, and I'm pretty 100% positive sure she's using TiddlyFox to save it because I walked her through that.
Huh.
But even when she's got TiddlyFox installed, if her muscle memory causes her to press file save, you know, TiddlyFox won't stop that.
Okay, so I chatted it to you, Jeremy, on the slide share.
Excellent.
So you should see it. We don't need that screen, do we? Because we're all here on the screen, right?
Yeah.
So we don't need that screen? Okay. So what I wanted to do in our talk today, and I have to bring up my, I want to bring up the same wiki, Rich Text Editor. That's what it was. Rich Text Editor to tiddlyspot.com?
Yeah.
Rich Text Editor hyphen, right?
Yeah, that's correct. I think .tiddlyspot.com.
We just worked on with this for about an hour. Oh yes, this is it. In class, and I wanted to see if as a technique for our group today, is if you walk me through it, and we chat about the nature of transclusion, and I want to chat with you about your thinking in the incision tool in particular. So strategy, okay. So we'll start with just some text. Let's do something different than September 11th. We'll do September 11th, that's fine. This is what we did in the last class, so it would be a good example to have the same text. Yeah, right, not that September 11th text, but this September 11th text. There it goes. Okay, so I did discover. We did discover accidentally, and you probably would know this and have a good reason for it, but if we decided we wanted to do one of these incisions here at this mm-hmm. stage, where's the third plane? And we do a tag, it gets tagged new tiddler.
Oh, yes, of course it would, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Thank you. Let me make a note of that.
And I don't know how else it could get tagged. But, so I'm just going to go back and save the text so it doesn't happen. But that was something that was not exactly what would have been expected, but when you think about it, I think it's probably reasonable. This is a fascinating concept. This gets, I think, the writers into actually using this incision tool into thinking through their transclusions in a very different way. Where did you come up with the idea? What were you thinking? I call it incision, I guess, but you're calling it an excision, right?
Yeah.
Not incision.
So I think we discussed possibly on one of the very early conversations about transclusion, my desire to do this. So the desire to, you'll recall that the innovation that was at the heart of the initial experiment of TiddlyWiki was the idea of multiple tiddlers at once to make it easier to refactor content. And then since then, although I endlessly talk about the importance of refactoring within hypertext writing, there hasn't been much support for it within TiddlyWiki. So now what you've got here, we've always had the mechanism of transclusion. So the ability to transclude with the double curly braces that we celebrate in the Design Right logo has always been in TiddlyWiki. And now what we've added is a user interface action that lets you directly express that operation. So I think it's a subtle difference, you know, a mechanism being supported versus an operation being supported feel to me slightly different, you know. So the operation in the sense of an operation that a user can perform within the constraints of the user interface. So that's there's never been anything preventing people from making transclusions in this way, but by bundling up this particular operation and making it into a, whatever it is, two or three click operation, hopefully we signal that this is an important operation. And so to be clear, what it does is it takes the selected text, puts it into a new tiddler, and then replaces the previous occurrence of the selected text with either a transclusion, a link, or a custom macro call that is invoked on the name of the tiddler that we've excisioned to. So,
in the previous workshop, we demoed all of those, and they all worked flawlessly, by the way.
Yeah, great, great. There's some rough edges to be knocked off before we're fixed, but it's mostly in the right direction. The name isn't quite right. I feel that this is an operation that deserves a, what's the word, a flagship name, a name that we take some trouble over, because this isn't, the action of the tool is not transclusion, partly because it can do all of these other things like linking. So I spent quite a long time fiddling around with thesauruses, trying to find appropriate words. Excision isn't quite right. It is an editorial expression. So an editor talks about, you probably get it better as excise rather than excision. And I think...
An excise tax. Yeah, okay. That's interesting. Yeah, so it's definitely doesn't mean for most people what you're wanting it to mean.
Row where it says more definitions, and you'll see the...
Oh, are there more? Okay. Yeah, I know the other...
Right, so it's that's the one.
Surgically.
But also remove a section from a text or a piece of music. Now, the trouble I have is that definition doesn't say anything about what happens to the thing that is exist. The implication, though, to everybody that I spoke to was if you excise something, was that you throw it away. So in every respect, I think it's almost precisely the wrong word, because we need a word that emphasizes what we do with the text that we cut out. So I did go through a brief cycle of trying to neologize, you know, playing with word roots, but transize was the closest I got, but transize, yeah. And then the problem number one is it's not even clear how you spell it. It doesn't feel like a natural word. I think in the past when we've neologized successfully.
I'll work on that. But there's a couple of things that I think it's really important. I think it's one of the most interesting developments we've seen. The fact it comes in the middle of our class is great for me and our students, I think, because it's like you said, it really turns it into an action instead of just a piece of code. It's something you do.
Yeah, instead of a latent capability. Yes, exactly that.
Yeah, it's very... So I did have a couple of questions and some thoughts about it. So what we just did could also be represented or... not problematic, but let me pull this up. I could imagine a use case where we want this text to remain where it was, but we want to also suggest that we're going to work on it more.
So it's sort of a way of marking text in place to say, oi, come back here.
Not quite. More
something more like an annotation?
Yeah, well, it like an update. So this came from one of the students who was using TiddlyWiki as sort of a research journal. So similar to what we might have in front of us here. But she comes across a concept that comes to her in one day. And then the next day she's going back over her notes and she wants to add something to that concept or change her current meaning of the concept, but doesn't want to lose the original.
Okay, I think that's what I'd call an annotation. And this is something, and echoes what we've just been talking about. It's a feature that I think is very important because it reflects a fundamental shift in how we think of writing. So the act of annotating versus the act of modifying, those are very different, I think. And in TiddlyWiki, we could express it as the ability to make a change to how a tiddler appears without modifying its modification date, you know, so it still keeps its position in the history. That's something I'd very much like to add as well. So the idea there would be that an annotation tiddler would be tied back to the tiddler that it annotates.
Well, it's not called annotation, though. So here's an example. So here's the original text is still in my original tiddler where I wrote it. And here's my current text. So if I'm, I can now go edit this and, you know, I can put new thoughts into here that are my current thoughts.
So is it more about the fact that you kept the original version so that you can do it side by side? Okay. Yeah. Well, I think that's one of the TiddlyWiki's missing features is not having a revision history. And as you noted elsewhere, there should be a one or more revisions associated with each Tiddler title. And when you refer to a Tiddler, you ought to be able to identify which revision you mean. And so I'd regard that as something that's missing, and it underpins quite a few important characteristics of ordinary wikis, some of which we can work around elsewhere. So the obvious one is if you have a revision history, it's easy to back out of changes. And for us, normally people working with a standalone wiki use Dropbox or something so they can roll back the entire file rather than individual tiddlers, which comes to much, which has a similar effect of helping save you from the worst disasters that can befall you. But the crucial thing I think about Tiddler history is by bringing the history of each Tiddler into the wiki, it gives us an opportunity to manipulate and examine that history. And the development of an idea over time seems like an important aspect of it that I might want to look at.
But I think that you're very close to doing that right here. So I will grab this.
Well, what you've done there is a good example, I think, of a sort of poor man's implementation of a feature that functionally in one or two use cases might give you exactly the same enough functionality. What I tend to see always is, you know, this quest for the small number of general purpose features that will together satisfy a wide range of requirements. One of the things that we can do with versioning, you see, is automatic diffing, because what you've done there, what one would really like now is an automated way of identifying the changes. And that's, you know, again, that's the sort of thing that we need to plumb in at the right level.
But I think, so like right where I am now, I'm about to use the excise tool, and I've got, I'll turn off the preview mode so that we can see more of it, right?
You could make it be fixed height as well, and then you, so the one that looks like a hanging spring, third from the right. Yeah, click that, and then choose fixed height.
Well, how much fun is that?
And so now the text box scrolls, but it means that you're never so far away from the toolbar.
Well, okay. So I've got my stuff at this moment. An option would be to, instead of replace the excise tax, leave in place the excise tax text and do a transclusion, or in this case, I might run it through the appear macro.
Yeah.
So I take my current text, have an appear that would automatically show me that text. And I think that would be instead of simply replacing, if you left it in place, that would allow you to do the substitution concept.
Yes, I mean, it's the kind of thing that when you look at each of these toolbar buttons is not surprisingly implemented as a single tiddler. And so it's very easy to clone them and modify them to experiment with them. And you'll see that the underlying mechanisms are very extensible. So one of the things that the stamp tool is interesting. So the stamp tool just inserts a canned block of text. So if you click on macro definition, it will, bang, just squirt out a macro definition. And if you click the same icon and then click on make my own, then that's a template for a tiddler that the body of which will become something that you can stamp out. So, put something there. So this is obviously designed as an end user feature. So people, while they're writing, if they find themselves repeatedly typing the same stuff, so you needed to change the caption field to give it a proper title. But that means... that you can visualize how a writer might, over time as they write, accumulate a sort of selection of snippets that help the writing process, and how in doing so they will have customized the tool that they're using to write. But what I like about it is that customization is, in a sense, at a rather high level. The entities that I create that appear on that menu are the cognitively significant entities for me, the things, the units that I find myself repeating. So I think it rather shifts the whole motion of the tool towards writers, and to, for the first time, giving people in the process of writing the ability to customize and extend the writing environment, by which I mean the text box into which you type, in exactly the same way that we do for the, what I might call the tiddler viewing environment, everything that's happening outside that text box into which you're typing.
That stamp tool I just wrote is a detransclusion tool.
That's right. Yep. I'm very good. Very good. Yeah.
And that's really interesting. That's something that I was thinking, wait a second, that's moving people in the opposite direction.
Somebody else has suggested the opposite feature, where one selects in the text box an existing transclusion, and then we pull up the content of that transclusion to delete the tiddler that's being transcluded and replace the transclusion with the text of the tiddler. So a literal detransclusion, whereas I think your point here is it's conceptually a detransclusion. But yes, all of that becomes possible, and all of that becomes malleable to people who are not experts in TiddlyWiki development. So all these editing operations, there are little bits of JavaScript that support doing the right thing. So for instance, if you select the word stamp and then press the H1 icon, you'll see that it correctly moves the exclamation mark to the start of the line. So there is JavaScript code that's moving back to the start of the line. But that code is just really simple string manipulation code. So if somebody wanted to write something that did really arbitrary manipulations to the text, they could do it without understanding the whole of TiddlyWiki. And that's a property that macros also have. So people can write JavaScript macros whilst understanding astonishingly little of TiddlyWiki. And so these are quite important points of extension for me, making it, it's inevitable that right in the heart of TiddlyWiki, you need to know your way around in order to create stuff or modify stuff. But in a few of these key points of extension, we can cater for people who have a much narrower view of what TiddlyWiki is doing.
Now, I had a question that was going to take us back to transclusion, and I've forgotten it. That's okay.
Well, while you're here, Steve, can I ask you to just scroll down a little bit and select in the, scroll down to the bottom of the Tiddler where there's the type field. And so that type field, change that content type with the drop down to ping image, PNG. Then scroll up a bit. Now the icon that's to the left of the down arrow, that's image size. Third from the right. Two more. That one. So click that. Then click the down arrow inside that box. Select maybe 600 by 371. Click resize image. Right, and so now you can select your drawing color with the left-hand button, the one to the left of where you are. So that drops down to colors. The one next to it is opacity, so you can draw with degrees of transparency. The one next to that is line width. So now draw in, and that clears the whole image, so you don't want to do that probably. And those are the only actions that are supported. So basically, the fun thing is if you change the opacity to be very low, 0.025 or something, and a nice big brush, and now you'll see how you get this quite nice sort of artistic effect. Where you can lay on paint and all accidental is not a goal of TiddlyWiki to be a tool for artistry. It does aspire to put graphics on the same, to make graphics be a first-class citizen along with text. And so a side effect of doing the toolbar for text was that it was very easy to do the toolbar for bitmap editing. And so again, I think having viable bitmap editing that people can actually use, and you'll remember before how it just you could just scribble with a yellow brush, does I think just cover a few more bases for us.
So out of curiosity, when I change the type to image ping from I didn't want to do that.
No, but it's funny, isn't it?
Yeah. Perhaps I did. What did I have before?
PNG.
No, I just had it as a straight TiddlyWiki 5.
Oh, that's that one, yeah.
That's gone, right?
Yeah, that old text is gone. As soon as you started to paint,
okay,
you overwrote the old content.
Okay.
As soon as you press done to
save it. Yeah. Okay, that's fine. I want to get. Boy, now I'm confused. So I'm gonna delete this. And we had a couple of weeks ago, taken a look at. This.
Oh yeah, you showed me this. I love this.
Yes, which we liked, and I thought was this is the one I'm working on here. And now I got to get back to that.
Browser tabs are the sloppiest bit of user interface in the world, aren't they?
It's just awful. I do this how many times a day looking for some stupid tab? Anyway, this one, there it is. It occurred to me that your snippet tool would work to do this kind of activity and make this kind of activity something that you could build. And
as part of the authoring process for this kind of thing.
Say that again?
So you could use the stamp tool as part of the authoring process for creating texts like this.
I see. Okay.
Is that what you mean?
I'm thinking of the excise tool itself, not the stamp tool.
Oh, the excise tool. Yes, yes.
But both of those, because I would love to see some of the people in the class.
So if you play this game to the end where you expand everything, you can get to the point where there are no gray rectangles. I'm sure you've got there as well. And when you get to that point, that is what feels like the full text. And then, yes, absolutely. One could imagine starting with that and repeatedly using the excision tool to build what we have here. Make a nice video. You know, choose some music, speed it up, take 10 minutes overdoing it. But you know, to make the object of art, not the artifact, but the process by which you made it.
Well, that's what I was thinking as for the transclusion exercise and the guided development portion of the second half of the class. So some students are working on their own projects. Some students are going to do a series of what I call guided developments of exercises that I'll write for them. And the first one is on transclusion. I really want to give them this tool. I think it's stable enough for them to use.
I will.
You're not sure.
My plan is to, as soon as the text editor is complete, to release 5.1.2. So, and I'm not going to work on anything else until I've completed it. I mean, within WWiki, I'm not going to work on anything else.
But it seems to work, and it doesn't seem to crash.
I think what I should do before you do it is at least what you're using is richtexteditor.tiddlyspot. What I should do is at least move it to the normal pre-release location. What you've got there is very much a sort of unsupported early preview. But anyway, yes, live on the edge. What could possibly go wrong?
Well, it says don't use for anything that's important, and I don't think this class is important in that sense.
No, learning is what's important, and yes,
quite. So, good. Because I think that excision tool is so transforms the transclusion experience, so I think we're going to try to use it. But I wanted to get your sense of what else you might suggest for students who are looking for an exercise to explore these concepts of transclusion, and where else you think that we might be able to push the text editor toolbar in the pursuit of new ways of transcluding or new ways of understanding transclusion.
Well, I guess a really obvious thought is to make you'd be a better judge of whether people already passed this, but to make people compare very directly the properties of the cognitive properties of links versus transclusions. So you could perhaps people could choose a text or be given a text and then make two attempts to hyperify it, one using links and one using transclusion. And I'd be very interested to then think about what kind of explorations those two different versions of the document might lend themselves to. I suspect at some level they're kind of interchangeable equivalent representations, but they don't feel at all equivalent and interchangeable, because to us cognitively they're so utterly, utterly different, chalk and cheese. So I'd be quite interested to look at that part of it. The other thing about transclusion, if you want to go more technical, is to start looking towards templating. So you'll recall that templating is the idea that you transclude a tiddler whilst maintaining the current tiddler as the tiddler it already was, so that within the transcluded tiddler, if it says display the title field, instead of displaying the title field of the transcluded tiddler, it displays the title field of the current tiddler, which is the one that did the transclusion. So Then it may be worth just taking it a little bit slowly, because
that's a key point. I'd love to understand it better.
Let's just go back. That of course this appears. We're walking up and down the sequence of tiddly concepts that we've identified, you know, quite early up front. And for me, transclusion and templating are adjacent in that stack. And the reason why is because transclusion is, has the purest relationship with transclusion. Templating is transclusion plus something else. So we introduce one additional concept to what we already have. When we built the ball up to the level where it contains transclusion, we add one extra thing, and then you get templating. And that one extra thing is this idea of the current tiddler. It's a critical one. It's the idea that as TiddlyWiki is processing, you know, it's trying to display a tiddler, it's doing it by navigating its way in and out of all the transclusions that you specified. And throughout that process, the engine maintains this idea of the current tiddler. Mm-hmm. And the purpose of it is so that then within Wikitext, you can say, instead of show me the title field of the tiddler community, you can say, show me the title field of the current tiddler. Mm-hmm. And that introducing that simple concept. So the concept is the idea of a current tiddler. The implementation is more complicated. The implementation is what we call variables, and is something that I would regard as outside the scope of our, you know, analysis of TiddlyWiki. But it's a very typical TiddlyWiki thing that we articulate the need for a very specific feature, and we satisfy it by implementing a very general purpose feature that actually satisfies a number of other needs at the same time. But the critical takeaway is this idea of the current tiddler. And so normally, when you transclude a tiddler, the current tiddler switches to that tiddler as well.
So if I'm going to create a new...
So create a tiddler, and then let's say...
So if I'm just transcluding the community tiddler.
Perfect. And then within the community tiddler, can we go and edit the community tiddler now and just add to the top of it a way to display what the current tiddler is? So edit that guy.
Where to go?
Mad scrolling. Just up at the top, type double angle brackets, current tiddler with a capital T, you know exactly what to do, and press the tick. Brilliant. And so now, interestingly, in the right, we can see that this is draft of community. So this, the tiddler you're editing right now, looks like it's the tiddler called community. It's actually a draft of it. And then when you press the tick, it'll now say current tiddler is community. So now back up to your example at the top, and we see that again current tiddler is community, but now precede the word community with a double vertical bar. So vertical bar is looks like that. Okay, inside the braces, that,
I didn't realize that. Yep.
Oh, not quite. Excellent. So now you can see that we've still got the text of the community tiddler, and above it, it says the current tiddler is draft of new tiddler. So now let's press the tick at this point.
Press the what?
The tick to finish editing the tiddler. And now we get what we might have expected. The current tiddler is new version of community tiddler. So that text, this is the current tiddler, that's generated within the tiddler community. But the reference to the current tiddler is the one from outside.
So then if I go down here, and
Don't forget to, you've left it in draft mode, so that might may confuse you when it doesn't reflect the changes that you've. So if you edit that new version, Tiddler, this isn't doing quite what you expected.
Almost.
On the right-hand side.
That's doing it, right? So that's bringing the field from the original Tiddler. And how do I bring it from this Tiddler? I can't, right?
You would, if you just remove the word community.
Of course, right.
Then you refer to the current Tiddler. And so this is another example of where the current Tiddler is used. So,
but I can't do this.
No, what would you expect that to do?
To show Howdy number one.
No, you'd, transclusion, that curly bracket syntax is essentially a shortcut syntax. But if you want to do complex transclusion, then you need to use the transclude widget.
Okay, that's going to get us past where we want to be in this class.
But that does allow you to transclude a field instead of, or a custom field. Whereas with the curly braces, it's more complicated than that.
Right, so now I've forgotten exactly where we were here. So perhaps this will take me back. No. So we were doing this, which basically what that does is brings in the community Tiddler, but keeps the current Tiddler where I'm at.
Exactly that.
Oh, so if I... But if I put... Okay, but if it's actually inside this other Tiddler.
So I think the example that might make more sense, is to press the tick on this one. Okay, and now go and edit the community Tiddler. Easiest way to get there is on the contents tab. You'll see it as one of the top level headings. Edit that. And now let's put in there double curly braces, double exclamation mark, Steve. So now I think this might be what you intended to do. So the community Tiddler has a field called Steve, and I can't quite remember, but if we scroll down, I think you put something in it. Down here, Steve has got Howdy number two from original Tiddler. So now press OK. So here we still see Howdy number two from the original Tiddler because the current Tiddler is set to the community Tiddler. But now if you scroll up to your new version of the community Tiddler, we now see Howdy number one. So now within our grasp, we've got all of the intricacies of templating. But basically, templating is writing a Tiddler that refers to calling it with the appropriate current Tiddler set so that it displays information about the Tiddler that you want.
So it might take several people or might take folks a few times to watch this over and over again to get that. Because this is a very, calling this here, that's very subtle because you're actually not calling it here, you're calling it somewhere else, and that's really subtle.
It's kind of like the payback of transclusion. So transclusion is admirably conceptually simple to understand. Add variables into the mix and you definitely get to a head swimming level of complexity, but it's the addition of the current Tiddler mechanism that really puts the power into transclusion and makes it be a generative tool. So within TiddlyWiki, the entire user interface that you see is a whole set of nested conditional transclusions and all of the magic happens by virtue of this process of the current tiddler being inherited. So what we're seeing here, for instance, the way that a tiddler is displayed with its title and the date and the toolbar and so on, that is a template tiddler that says display the title here, display the toolbar here. And then the story mechanism is just repeating that template for each of the tiddlers that need to be displayed in the current story.
So we were playing with that before, with the view template. And this is probably, this looks worse than it is to actually edit and mess around with.
Yeah, this stuff, it ends up being complicated because of TiddlyWiki's features, like you can independently switch off and on toolbar buttons, that kind of thing. So there's a lot of plumbing to maintain the user interface that's actually just rather gets in the way of a pedagogic explanation. So I think the example that we ended up with of showing the Steve field from the two places, that's the perfect canonical example to illustrate this phenomenon of the current tiddler mechanism within transclusion. And I would say it's good to reference the mechanism that is used for the display of tiddlers within the story, but I'd leave that can of worms closed unless you really want to scare people.
Okay. But if they wanted to modify the default view template,
then normally what we do is we encourage people to add existing, what we call, add new, what we call segments to the view template. So each part of the tiddler, so that's the title, the toolbar, the body, are structured as independent segments. And you can interleave your own segments arbitrarily within the... So particularly, you see this in the edit mode more, where you've got the type and then the other fields and so on. So there's a number of sort of distinct vertical sections within a tiddler. And because the trouble with overwriting the view template is, of course, that you're messing with TiddlyWiki's operation. It's possible to break TiddlyWiki. Now, that's fun, but one tries to minimize how easy it is to do that accidentally.
This is the default view template, title, tags, and text field.
There's some other... interestingly, I mean, a typical taste of how much hidden complexity, I guess, there is within software. If I actually go and look at the source code, there's a number of other segments that you... there's a special segment for tiddlers formatted in TiddlyWiki classic formatting, where a warning banner appears. There's a special segment for tiddlers that are like the import tiddler. There's a special section for handling the fold-unfold mechanism. So, again, that it's the sort of thing that you'd expect, that TiddlyWiki tries very hard to wear its complexity lightly and, hide as much complexity as possible.
But if we wanted to, for example, modify those that we see and we wanted to move the tags to the top.
Yeah, the easy way of doing that would be to find the tiddler, the system tiddler called tags/view template. And that's the one. And edit the list field of it. And it's a shadow tiddler, but it's designed to be overridden. It's very difficult to edit the list field. So I typically at that point would do a select all and copy and paste it to the text field just so that I can edit it more easily.
So if I put the tags here.
Yeah, I think you moved the subtitle as well, but
I didn't need to do that. Oh, I see what I did, yes. close. What's the subtitle of a tipper?
It's the place where it gives the username and the date.
Oh, okay. So if I just save, I mean, this is, I'm editing your tiddly spot, so I don't care.
Yeah, it went so bad. But there's hardly anything with a tag in it. Gosh. Oh, did you move the stuff back into the list field?
Ah, right. No. Of course not. So then I just grab all the content. So I have to put them back on separate lines, or can I just paste them right here?
You should be able to just paste them. Yeah.
Oh, there it is. Tags are on top.
And so one of the things that we're seeing here is
that level we can handle. Beyond that, we can't. And I have one question. This is for several projects. If I'm editing this, and instead of calling, I wanted to call this instead. I want to call another template altogether. I just put it here, right?
No. What's going on here is that list field determines the order of the segment. In order for something to be a segment, it has to carry the appropriate tag, which all of those tiddlers do. So if you click on one of the links on the right-hand side, just click on one of those, then edit that tiddler, you'll see edit that tags tiddler.
It just has to be tagged to view template.
Exactly that. Exactly.
Okay. So if I got it. Now I know why tags are showing up twice, because I left it tagged. Okay.
The other thing, I don't think we'll have time to get into it, but the alternative to the list field is the list before and list after fields. So the reason why they can be useful is that means you only need to modify one tiddler. So for the very common use case of I want to add a new segment and I want it to be immediately below the title, then you'd just give the segment that tag and you'd use list before or list after to indicate, to constrain it to be next to the title field.
And what are the problems with changing shadow tiddlers?
The problem is if you then upgrade to a new version of the TiddlyWiki core, your modification will mask the upgraded shadow tiddler. In a case like this, where what you've modified is purely a list field, that doesn't really matter. So there are some shadow tiddlers that are explicitly designed to be overridden. And the great advantage is if you don't like what you did, you can delete your tiddler and the shadow tiddler returns. But for something like that view template tiddler that we looked at, to modify that, you know, in the future, it's quite likely that we'll need to modify that view template in order to add some new feature to the core in the future. And so for people who've modified that tiddler, they would then be in a sort of intermediate state where some of their components were modified versions of the old components and some of them were new ones. So it's what we
call a
configuration management problem.
Well, that technique of tags is something that we're working on for, I think, 5 or 6 different projects. So it's been vexing me. So I took advantage of you to ask that question, but it will work. But I understand now the template and the transcluding. So that was a very interesting and helpful discussion, and I think our discussions as we move forward to the projects and the stuff, we're going to start as students start handing in bits of their projects, we're going to start critiquing them and viewing them and getting suggestions, but also kind of move through this kind of process of transcluding, tagging, linking again, just to, I think now that everybody's familiar with it, the conversations will hopefully, we can take it to the next level, so we're kind of cycle back through them again.
I'd just like to throw one little thing in here. Hegert, who's very active on the group, recently posted a link to his, I think, weekly report.
Yes.
And so I read through those and was again struck by how terrific Hegert's engagement is. And how amazingly effective the course has been. I mean, Haggart's notes are actually kind of touching, if I can put it that way. It's really charmingly written. I think speaks a lot about the value of the process that we're going through in the course. So I wanted to ask you whether you had any plans to aggregate the students' writing. So, you know, we've got all these exercises and so on distributed as separate Dropbox items. I think something that would be really, again, an interesting task within and rather within the scope of the course would be to try and pull some of that together to give some multifaceted flavor of what it's been like for the participants in the course.
Yes, I think what I'm starting to do, and I'm behind on these, but I'm starting to write critiques. And so these are all wikis now that I own, so they don't go away when the students go away.
We need to draw a map of all the wikis you've created for this.
Yes, that would be nice, right? And using the template technique.
Yeah.
So I just created a crit template, and all it does is writes the contents of the field crit at the bottom of any tiddler tagged with crit. And so that way, as I make my own copy of it.
Can I make a suggestion for an alternative way of doing it?
Oh, yes, please. Because this is...
The downside of what you've done is that in order to add a critique to a tiddler, you need to modify that tiddler. And so that means, for instance, that you can't use the last modification date to distinguish your stuff from other stuff, for instance. So another alternative is to add a view template segment that, given that it knows the current tiddler, it attempts to transclude a tiddler with the same title as the current tiddler, plus the prefix dash critique. And then if that tiddler doesn't exist, it will not be displayed. If that tiddler does exist, then it will be displayed, for instance, at the bottom. So that would allow you to critique a tiddler by just cloning it and giving your clone the same title with dash critique at the end. Does that make sense? It's actually the simplest version of the annotation stuff that we were talking about before. So yeah, I mean, maybe a dash or brackets or something, some simple convention for mapping. Yeah, exactly that. And then in our view template, and there's a couple of, it's not a trivial view template. Well, there's a view template that would need writing to the exclusion of the suffixed title. But I could help you with that offline, Steve.
Yeah, and I think that would work too. I have to get, because I wasn't super thrilled with this method because of exactly what you suggested. The cloning method.
And typing into the tiny box is no fun.
Exactly, right. My comment's good. Yeah, but you can change that too, right?
Yeah, a bit of a hassle, but you can. Yeah. I think the text field of all the fields in a tiddler is designed to be the one that one writes long text in. So although one can write long text in other fields, one's sort of swimming against the tide and should only do it when there's no alternative. I think the more kind of idiomatic way of doing things is to keep the text that you write in the text field.
I see. Have you ever thought of tiddlers with two text fields?
Yes. So a topic that you... that's always bubbling away is my small list of things that I would like to fundamentally change in TiddlyWiki, and one of them is that it should be possible for a tiddler to have multiple copies of any field, including title and including text. Okay. So I think the data model that we have at the moment in the background, I think, was a mistake, having multiple fields would have given us a more natural way of coping with lists and a more natural way of coping with aliasing.
Was actually misphrased.
Oh, go on.
Have you ever thought of having two fields in a tiddler that have the characteristics of the current text field? They could have different...
Oh, yeah, but you can do that. That's so you could create a view template segment called text2 that does exactly the same things as the normal template, but to the but to another text field. So yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Well, okay. I'll offline. I'll send you an email about your suggestion about the critique, because I think that that's an important piece that I hadn't really realized that I needed to have until I needed to critique them. But I like, you know, my critique template kind of works for me at the moment. It's a little annoying. And I pretty much understand your method, but I'll ask about it if I don't. So thanks for that conversation. I think next week, we'll see where we go. I'll see how the transclusion exercise works out, and we'll see what we need to work with it. In terms of other macros that facilitate transclusion, I was going to stick with a peer. Do you have any other suggestions that we should look at other than a peer?
No, not really. I mean, some of the fun things that have come up in the discussions in the group is people, you know, abusing the mechanism to do things that that weren't intended, and that would be the best outcome of your experiments. I think.
Okay. Well, I think a peer is good enough. I mean, it's got a lot of flexibility.
Absolutely. Yeah. It tells a clear story. Thank you very much, Steve. I'll leave you guys to it, but enjoy your day in Boston, and I'll look forward to speaking to everybody next week.
Okay, great.
Bye. Bye.
Yep. And so let's stop share and stop recording.